Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:02 p.m. Central Time on the 12th of April, 2017. And welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet and we issue semi-daily weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. So, guys, okay, we just lost our audio there for some reason. I don't know why, but I think we got it fixed. Hopefully you can hear me now. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Okay, well, it's still 10:02 and now going into 10:03. Guys, it looks like we're starting out with about 542 different people in the different chats between Twitch and YouTube and Facebook and my website. So it's really good to see everybody in here. Let's dive right into it. Hope we don't have any more technical difficulties. That seems to be something that's been popping up recently. Don't know what's causing all that, but we'll just ignore it and move on like it didn't happen. Guys, look what struck today. Now, we talked about Guam getting hit last night, and we checked Guam off the list. We talked about the halfway silent points, for instance, in between Taiwan and South Japan near Okinawa. And look what hit. And in case you see that, don't see this on your screen, it says 5.1, but if we go look up our station locations, it tops out at 5.7. Multiple mid-range 5s detected on that, and that is the earthquake we were looking for. Now, I was looking in between Taiwan and South Japan, more towards the northeast portion of Taiwan, and instead it struck up here near Okinawa. Well, okay, I mean, that is an earthquake forecast hit. I said it wouldn't be causing any damage, it was going to be striking out to sea, etc., etc., and that's exactly what happened. So that being said, guys, look what else is going on. We've got a new deep earthquake below western Japan. Technically, that's in between the waters between Korea and Japan. And in case you guys don't know what's going on, internationally speaking, there's a carrier strike group, U.S., that's just, sailing into the area, and there's a nuclear test getting ready to happen in North Korea. And a lot of people are talking about it on the international scene that they're worried that there may be something that happens off that. Now, I'm not getting into the whole war scenario. I'm just telling you guys, there's a deep earthquake right down below where we would expect maybe to see naval vessels of all sorts starting to pile up there to get off the shores to see what's, you know, of course, they're going to be monitoring that. So just be aware we have a deep earthquake down below there. And a deep earthquake means a shallower, larger earthquake is imminent in the area to the west of this location. To the west. So what's to the west? Okay, obviously we go into China, we get up to the Himalayan range. So a deep 4.5 can cause a shallow 5 to 5.5 in areas to the west. And it could even go larger, but I'm going to put it at a 5 to 5.5. To the west. It just so happens to time up with their nuclear test. Now, is it going to strike in North Korea with the nuke, or is it going to strike further to the west over in China? We have to watch both locations. Now, you see where our red arrow kind of comes across the northern part of the Himalayan range? Well, in between the red arrow and our deep earthquake, we are going to see pressure transfer to the west on its way over towards Europe. Speaking on its way over towards Europe, yesterday we talked about our deep 4.3 that happened here where our letter D is. And I said, once pressure gets to here and it's still deep, it usually carries on deep over to the west and that we'd see some new deep earthquakes associated with Italy. Well, look what happened today, guys. A new deep earthquake down in the Tyrrhenian Sea. Now, it's a 2.4, but the depth is 236 kilometers. I consider anything over 200 kilometers to be quote-unquote deep. Anything under 200 kilometers is more in the crust than it is down in the asthenosphere. And when we have deep earthquakes down below, they can cause 1 to 2 magnitudes larger up above. This has happened before down in the Tyrrhenian Sea. We saw a deep 5.8 down here where this 2.4 is. We saw a deep 5.8. several months ago, and that was followed the next day by the shallow 7.0 earthquake that caused so much damage. Well, now it's just a deep 2.4. The highest this could go would be 4.4. Ironically, what are we looking for? We're looking for a 4 to 4.5 to be striking. So we have a new deep earthquake there, and technically, a semi-deep earthquake, not over 200 kilometers, but just under 200 kilometers over in Greece, letting us know that deep pressure is coming up from down below, and it's trying to seek a way up. At this point, we should be warning central Italy for that 4.0 earthquake to strike within the next 2 days, 1 to 2 days at the most. Like I said, by Friday night, okay, well, here we are. They are already in Thursday, and by Friday night, the 14th, we should be reporting on that 4 striking back in central Italy. And now we have a deep earthquake to justify that. On top of it all, a swarm has developed out in north Italy on the plate boundary. And in case you guys don't know about these plate boundaries, I should get a USGS map open here so we can take a look at the USGS marked plate boundaries versus what I would normally show you. And they're somewhat similar, and our arrows match a lot of this because these are the plate boundaries. The way the pressure moves is that pressure comes from down to the south, where we saw our previous activity, south of Crete. And let me get a display capture on here. Okay, hopefully you guys will be able to see this. Okay, here we go. Now we're looking at the USGS page. And take a look at this. Okay, we're looking at the plate boundaries here in Europe. And the red line indicates where the plate boundary is between Africa and South Europe. And we saw our previous earthquake strike south of Crete. And then pressure was exerted up to the west-northwest, and it went right along our plate boundary, striking at central Italy here, northwest of L'Aquila. And now today, a new swarm breaking out. Let's show you where. And turn down our rings. Northwest of Norcia, northwest of central Italy. So what's northwest of central Italy? Let's go back to our plate boundary map. Look what curves over and goes to the west and dead ends into Torino, the plate boundary. So, what's going on here? Pressure has come up out of Crete, struck at central Italy, now pushed further north, and struck right along the plate boundary, and I mean directly on it, in the river plain, next to Bologna. And it's going to carry on, like we told you guys. North Europe, Central Europe would become re-excited. Central France was struck today, and we're going to look for the English Channel to get a new earthquake. And it's going to be similar in size to what strikes down to the south. Like I said, it should be in the 3-ish range. Well, these are all 2.7s coming up from the south. If you add a couple of these together, that equals about 3 anyways. So we're looking for a 3.5, to be striking in the English Channel within the next couple days as well. We also told you guys to watch down to the south, and this is going a little bit further south than I would expect, and this is the second time this has happened in the past 2 months, where we saw a new set of earthquakes strike at a set of islands that don't normally get hit, which is the Canaries. And people have talked about the Canaries, and they worry about the Canaries and the Azores, and there's two sets of islands, one at each set of volcanic chain here, where the islands have split in half, and there's two different islands that could split and send a giant tsunami out into the ocean. Well, we're not worried about that happening right now. It's just being struck further to the south. We don't have an arrow that goes down there, but this is the second time this has happened in the past couple months. Normally, pressure transfers just to the west and strikes at the Azores. Canaries hardly ever get hit. So to have the Canaries on the list means there could be some kind of volcanic activity at play here. And I'm going to talk about the volcanism in a second, because it's a dramatic increase. Let's just open that up right now. Okay, 13th and 12th is what we're looking at here. We have Chivalouche and all the regular suspects on the list, but the number of eruptions at each one of them. Look at how many times Dukona's on the list. Look at how many times Sabankaya's on the list. Look at how many times Cinnabung's on the list. Okay, all today. All the different volcanoes going back to yesterday. So that's we're carrying on with a noteworthy amount of eruptions, but the locations have dramatically been reduced. Sabankaya, here, where the letter V is. All the other volcanoes, all the way along South America, Central America, have gone quiet. As we go over here to the west, again, Dukono here and Cinnabung here. All the others have gone quiet. Suwanizajima up in Japan, Sakurajima up in Japan, gone quiet. Kambalny gone quiet. Kluchevskoy has gone quiet. I mean, how many more? Bagana, Ambrim, White Island, all of them have gone quiet. And whenever there's quiet when it comes to volcanic eruptions, that's when we see an increase in seismic activity around all these previous volcanoes that moved. And since we had so many, And you guys, if you've been paying attention over the past several weeks, it's just ramped up and up and up. But now we're back to two, one basically, or two on one side, one on the other of the Pacific. And that means we're looking at larger earthquake activity coming. But where? Where is the larger earthquake activity going to strike? Well, that's the question. That's the million-dollar question. We've got an answer for you. We can look at our silent zones to determine where the next round of activity is going to be striking. For instance, we have a silent zone. Now that Japan has been hit in between Taiwan and Japan, we have a new silent zone that's developed out in between the 5.1 and all the way up here at Shivalush Volcano. So right here where our letter V is. Now if we find the halfway point between the letter V and the earthquake to the south, that will determine where our next earthquake up here in the Northwest Pacific is going to strike. The halfway point. Now, not as the crow flies, but as the fault bends. And as I'm looking at it here, let's wait for this to refresh. Our halfway point brings us into near Hokkaido, right where our, see where the arrow kind of comes in and does a bend and then goes up? Here at Hokkaido would be the next spot to be hit. It's the halfway point between these two zones. So North Japan should be put on watch. And for how large of an earthquake? Well, it's going to be consistent with the rest that struck. Now, they downgraded these, each one of them, like I showed you last night. This one was a 5.5. And I showed you this one. Did I show you this one? Here, let's show it to you. Let's show it to you. You guys need to see the station locations yourself. You don't have to take my word for it. See how they have it at 5.1? I'm going to read a few of these to you off the list. 5.1, 5.7, 4.7, 5.3, 4.7, 5.6, 5.5, 5.0, 5.4, 5.7, 4.5, 5.0, 4.9, 5.1, 5.3, 5.4, 5.7, 4.4. So they're going with the fours. They're taking those fours, and there's so many fives on the list that it really, guys, it's a mid-range five, just like the other one down to the south at Guam. I told you, they do a half-magnitude downgrade on almost each one of these now. With that happening, that means the next spot to be struck will be more like a 5.5, and they won't be able to hide it this time because it's not going to be out in the ocean. It'll be more near close to on land, and they'll have to accurately report the magnitude, which will put it at the 5.5 to 5.6 range. Maybe even higher. So watch up at Hokkaido. We're going to watch for 48 hours. So that's only 2 days. It's already the 13th overseas. So by Saturday night, that should happen. Okay. Now let's talk about the Philippines. I know I've got a lot of viewers that are concerned about what's going on there. That's a big deal what's going on here right now. If you take into account that right here in the middle of all this, we have Dukono Volcano and Ibu Volcano, right here where our letter V is. Both of those erupting over and over again. Dukono and Ibu. They're on the list several times this past week. Up to your north, take a look at all the 5.0 activity. I'm going to get all the fours off there, and we're only going to look at the fives and greater. Look what's happened to the north. Do you see this? Do you see how this almost makes like a circular shape around where it's followed the bends in the plate, and there's only a few other areas that haven't been hit? If you were looking at this just by the earthquakes that have struck 5.0 and greater, it would tell you Philippines is an area where there's obviously something going on, and it's covering the whole section of the plate from north-central Philippines all the way down to where it meets up with Indonesia and Malaysia. So what does it mean? It means that there could be a larger earthquake on the perimeter, but it won't strike until this stops. And it just keeps on moving. It appears to be moving to the south. So it started to the north and has moved to the south. Now look which way we have our arrows on here. We have omnidirectional arrows. We have north and south facing arrows. And the progression started here and has worked its way to the south, which means most likely where this meets up with our letter D is going to be our next spot to be hit by a similar sized earthquake. And they've all been 5.8 and 5.9s. So how long would that take to happen? Well, I would say within 72 hours or less. So within 3 days, we should be seeing at least a 5.8 striking down here in western Papua New Guinea, right where our letter D is, okay? It's progressing to the south. So you might also ask, well, what about Taiwan? Well, now that the 5.1 has hit just to the north of Taiwan, technically there is a new silent zone in between these two halves as well. But since the pressure has released to the north, that means most likely the pressure has bypassed or transferred across this area naturally and not caused any large earthquake, that the pressure shifted to the north and it struck here next to Okinawa. And now the next thing that it's going to happen, it's going to go up further to the north. It's going to keep following the river flow and go up and strike at our next halfway point between the next volcano and the earthquakes, okay? So I hope that explains things for you. Now, as we go over into the United States, we need to talk about this, guys. The slow slip event up here in the northwest United States. And first of all, MC Player, our resident programmer, so to speak, has found an article from late February where they're talking about the slow slip event starting and that it's nothing to be alarmed about, that it happens every few years, yada, yada, yada. We've heard it all before. That's fine. That's cool. We don't want to downplay any event, but we also don't want to overplay an event. So I understand what the professionals were talking about back in February by saying it's nothing to worry about, because it does happen every few years, and only every once in a while do we see these very large earthquakes that develop off the slow slips. Usually, it's almost every single slow slip event is accompanied by larger earthquakes at the end. It's just a matter of how big do they get. Like over in Japan in 2011, it was an area 500 miles across that was moving, first of all, not just 50 miles or 150 miles, but 500 miles across. Secondly, it was being accompanied not just with zeros, ones, and twos, but twos, threes, fours, fives, and even a seven mixed in with that before the big one hit. So that slow slip event back in 2011 on the coast of Japan, happening all along the coast of Japan from Hokkaido down to the south tip of Honshu, that those two locations in Japan were swarming simultaneously across the whole island. Well, right now here in the United States, over the last several weeks, let's say now confirmed to be at least since February 25th. Now, just think about that. That's 2 months. Now, that this has been occurring. And what has been occurring? A slow slip event that started up in the Olympic Peninsula. It crept up into central Vancouver Island, and then it stopped there a few days ago. It picked back up, and let me show you where it picked back up, yesterday, down here to the south, down in Oregon. And it swarmed out with near 100 earthquakes spread around the area at Grants Pass. We determined that area to be a dead-end zone for the faults off the coast, and relatively at the same time that this swarm was occurring, that 4.2 struck off the coast here of the northwest portion of California and western portion of Oregon. I'll highlight that in blue. So this 4.2 that struck, here, there it is, this 4.2 that struck almost at the same time that that swarm was happening down in South Oregon. Now let's go forward to today. So this is yesterday's earthquakes. Here's the last 24 hours, and you'll see that the number was cut in half. Maybe I need to zoom this in a little bit so you can see how many we're talking about here. The rest of the zone, just one or two earthquakes. Literally, one at the Olympic Peninsula, three south of Olympia, two over next to Mount Hood, and then just a couple. But the swarm that we were looking at down in South Oregon, look what happened over the past 12 hours. Last 6 hours, last 3 hours. In other words, in the last 12 hours, the swarm down in Oregon has completely ceased. And if you take a look at the rest of the earthquakes across the entire region, they're equidistantly spaced, almost in a zigzag formation that mimics what's going on off the coast. So let me show this to you. Look at the shape. Look at the zigzag shape of this off the coast. This is the Juan de Fuca Cascadia fracture zone that everybody's familiar with and that people are worried about for the large, big earthquake to strike, okay? And take a look at it. Now, let's go back to the PNSN site, or the University of Washington site. And you see how it almost makes a zigzag shape like that if you were to connect these dots? Well, that zigzag shape mimics what's going on off the coast. So the earthquakes that are striking interior on land are mimicking whatever pressure is pushing from off the coast. Now, the 4.2 that struck yesterday is going to do two things. It's already doing it right now. It's going to excite things across California, going down to Southern California, all the way down to the south, just south of the border, actually. And in the next day or two, at the most, it's going to be causing a new swarm back in Oklahoma and Kansas at the fracking operations. In between there, we're going to see a new earthquake and small swarm develop out at Yellowstone Park. And it's a lot to happen. It's all going to happen very quickly. And I'm going to turn on our smaller earthquakes to get a better look at what we're talking about here. So if you live in the Northwest, here's what's going down. Your slow slip event started 2 months ago, basically, Professionals said the longest that they've seen before was relatively 6 weeks to 7 weeks at the most. Well, we are 6 to 7 weeks in on when they were talking about it back in February, at the end of February, go throughout all of March, all and now half of April. And here we are. The slow slip event has stopped. And if the slow slip event has stopped, what does that mean for us overall? It means we've got ourselves a little bit of an issue going on here. When the slow slip events stop, that's when we see an increase in chance of a larger earthquake to strike. So what do I think is going to happen here? Since the area shifted to the south, that may have been the last hurrah on the slow slip. And it would make sense. It's the southern portion of the area that was slipping up to the north. The whole area to the north slipped at the north tip of this. And then it would make sense that the southern tip would compensate in some way. But now that it's stopped, and over the last 12 hours into 24 hours, there's just a handful of earthquakes compared to the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds that were happening over the past several weeks, it means the slow slip event has stopped. So if there was going to be a time where I were to wave my hands around, sound a horn, and tell you to watch out for an earthquake to strike in the next few days, it would be now. Finally, we're here. The slow slip event has stopped. Is it going to pick back up tomorrow? I don't know. I don't normally forecast for these slow slip events. All I can tell you is that we're looking at the most recent earthquakes, and the most recent earthquakes show us that the slow slip event has stopped. There's just a few compared to the hundreds. And we know from past experience, 2012 being the most recent example on the West Coast, that when the slow slip stops, that's when the potential for the large one strikes in an area nearby the slow slip event. Well, there's two zones here. There's two spots that just slipped. This one, up here to the north, majorly slipped across central Vancouver, going down into the Olympic Peninsula in Washington. And then down to the south, a minor slippage, maybe a compensation on the other side of the zone. So if I were to lean towards an area that would get struck, it would be between these two areas. It's fairly simple. Even a child could see it. You have two zones that are moving. That's the spot that's moved. That means that's the area that's going to be getting the large earthquake, the compensation movement on the edge of it, the perimeter. After all this gets done, then it compensates. And it's happened before. October 27, 2012, 7.7 earthquake struck this area right after the slow slip. Now, we hope history doesn't repeat. And we're learning, I'm learning as I'm going along. I don't know if anybody else is, but I am paying attention very close every day and telling you as I discover it, as I find it, as I see it, so that when it happens or doesn't happen, we can base rules on this for the future, for future slow slip forecasting, okay? So it's a big deal for me whether or not we're getting it right. Speaking of getting it right, already, and I'm just showing you, two small earthquakes, two microquakes, have returned back to the Yellowstone Magma Chamber, one inside the park itself and the other up in Montana on the edge of the magma chamber that's 11 Grand Canyons in size, in case you guys, you know, didn't hear that in the last 1,000 updates that I've done. But looking at California, the other spot we're going to watch, now that a 4.2 has struck up here yesterday, we have to watch all the way down here in Southern California, just southeast of San Diego, so that not many people live here, but it'll be just south of Salton Sea, and it should go up into the 4.0 range. If it's a 3.9, don't fault me, but I'm more looking more like a 4 because a 4.2 struck up here. The areas in between are already being lit up, but these stacks are going to increase through the roof. Most likely, central eastern California, back at our volcanoes, Mono Lake going into Aurora Crater, because pressure is going to be transferring across this area over the next day to 2 days, the volcanoes are going to light up. You're going to see stacks of earthquakes. Make note how many there are now. Just one at each location, right? These are all the smaller earthquakes, so, you know, even the zeros. So there's like one or two at each location. This will be stacks of earthquakes at each location, letting you know that pressure has resaturated the area and is coming down to Southern California. So if you do know anybody that lives there, let them know not to panic. That it's a 4, and the reason a 4 is striking is because whenever we see activity up here to the northwest, it pushes all of California, and it pushes it all the way down to the south where you have a volcano just south of the border, Cerro Prieto, and it's kind of the blocking point or the spot where the magma chamber catches most of that pressure before it goes down in the Gulf of California, which it can happen sometimes when there's a lot of pressure coming down off the coast. like what happened this past week. One other thing, since all the earthquakes stopped in the Midwest, look what also stopped on the East Coast. No earthquakes up the East Coast, Southeast Canada, nowhere. Oh, I mean, 1.9 at the Tennessee border, which is insignificant. Actually, that would be the leftovers off what happened a few days ago, in case you guys missed that. Here, let me turn that back on really quick. Here we go. USGS last 7 days. Take a look at our smaller earthquakes from a day ago, and you'll understand why 1.9 hit in the East Coast. So see that? Okay, multiple twos in the Midwest, 1.9 on the East Coast. Now, I don't know how I missed this, but a 1.3 in New York City? What? No, Connecticut? What? Hold on. Where is this? New Milford? New Milford. Northeast of New York by a few miles. Huh. I wonder what this is. How did we miss this yesterday? Depth 8.1 kilometers. Well, it's not every day we see one of these. Hey, East Coasters, listen up. The reason you guys get struck is because the Midwest got struck. It all got struck this past week, and you guys stand on the edge of the craton, but this is real close. 8 kilometers down below. What do we have here? Mount Tom. Never heard of it. Mount Tom. What is it, an old volcano? Wouldn't that be funny? Right? You got old volcanoes up there in New York? I don't know. I have no clue. It's not marked. But this is definitely on the edge of the craton. Take a look at this. Let me turn off our... Now that you know where we are, here's New York City, in case you guys, you know, famous downtown New York, Manhattan, right? Okay, there you go. And we'll back that out and show you where it is. Our earthquake right here. I guess that's two counties to the north. And zooming in on it, you see the mountain ranges here, how they go down to the southwest? They all kind of point in one general direction. Okay, that's not due to weathering, guys. We'll back that out and show it to you. It's actually the interior edge of the craton, or the exterior edge of the craton. And I mean directly on the exterior edge. And it's highlighted by the forests that are on the mountain ranges. It goes up to the north. You can follow the crack and the split all the way out to the sea, and then it bends out, and you can almost make out, you should be able to make out the channel here. That's not made by humans. This is, you know, 50 miles across or more. I don't, how many miles is, I have no idea. That's just a random guess. 70 miles, no, 60 miles across. And that's formed naturally by the split in the craton. So you guys struck on the East Coast even by 1.3. I'm not shocked, because the Midwest saw that swarm over the past several days. Well, that's all died out. That's all gone quiet. And that's going to change in the next couple days with that 4.0 that already struck on the coast, okay? So several things going on right now. Southern California at the border, 4.0 activity expected in the next couple days. New swarm activity at Eastern California, but it shouldn't be too large. And the potential in the Pacific Northwest on the edge of our slow slip area, which now we have determined exists between Vancouver Island, Olympic Peninsula, and Southwest Oregon. So that zone is the zone that slipped. Most of the slipping happened to the north, which means the earthquake is likely to strike to the north. Where to the north? To the north of the northernmost part of the slow slip event that happened, which encompasses the northern part of Vancouver Island, BC, going up into the Hecate Strait, which is east of this Haida Gwaii, and I'm probably butchering that, but the east of the island there in the Hecate Strait, which is northwest of Vancouver Island. And we're watching there for the next several days. How about, let's put it on a 5-day watch, not a warning, because this is something I don't normally forecast on, but we'll put it on a watch. Now, the difference between a watch and a warning in weather is huge. A watch is a giant area that you're just watching generally for something to happen in. The warning is when something's been spotted and you know imminently that it's coming down on top of you. Usually they wait for a trained spotter or for it to actually be visibly observed. In this case, we can visibly observe that the earthquakes in the areas have stopped. And we visibly observed the areas that moved, which means we can visibly observe and estimate with a high degree of accuracy which area is going to move next with the larger movement, the compensation movement. Like I said, It's going to be striking on the perimeter of the area that just slipped for the last month and a half. You can imagine a whole area moves across 150 to 500 miles all the way down to Oregon. But 150 miles across up to the northwest majorly slipped across Olympic Peninsula and Vancouver Island. That will result in the area surrounding that with one single snap of an earthquake that compensates for all that movement over the last month and a half to 2 months. And that's what led me to think that we're looking for a 6 to 6.5. Now, do I need to up that? No. At this point, it's stopped. So there's no additional energy to add to that unless there's any new push from up here to the north. So it's just a matter of, I would say, a few days if anything's going to strike. Now, there is another possibility that the slow slip picks back up. Tomorrow, we tune back in and there's 1,000 new earthquakes that are back on the feed, which would mean the slow slip event would be picking back up. I don't know. That will tell. We'll know tomorrow. We'll know tomorrow whether or not the slow slip event is fully dead for the last 2 days, or is it going to pick back up somewhere else? Somebody else proposed a possibility to me that there are smaller slow slip earthquakes happening out to sea that are not being reported by the NEIC, since the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network is only reporting to us the smaller earthquakes close to their network. According to the person who runs the network at the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network, they're not capable, his network is not capable of detecting 5.0 earthquakes down off the coast of Oregon, for instance. That the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network's not capable of detecting 4s and 5s off the coast. And that was the responsibility of the National Earthquake Information Center. This is a quote from the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network director, John Vidal. And when he said that to me, I said, okay, well, all right, now we've got an answer. So his network's not capable of detecting 4.0 or greater earthquakes, which if they can't detect 4s, then that would mean they can't detect 3s, 2s, 1s, or 0s either off the coast. And if they can't detect 3s, 2s, 1s, or 0s off the coast, then we're looking at there's a possibility that there is a swarm happening off the coast that we're not seeing and that no one's showing us, but someone somewhere would know about. They're just not showing us, because it's someone else's responsibility. It doesn't show up on the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network, and it doesn't show up on the USGS website. It would be on the NEIC server somewhere. No one's showing to us. I don't know. But all I know is that it's silent, and there's two possibilities. One, it's silent. Two, there's earthquakes that aren't being reported to us. Those are pretty much the options. And I don't like having to guess like that, but I can tell you that if I were to watch the area, I would watch the area to the north. And that's why we're warning the area around Vancouver Island, because Vancouver Island was the last spot to be hit. I hope that's a good detailed explanation for everybody. I don't want to alarm you, but I do want to tell you we're watching for a 6 to 6.5. And if it strikes on land as opposed to out to sea, if I'm off on this and it strikes on land, you'll want to be prepared for it. It'll knock things off shelves. It'll scare the hell out of you. If it strikes in the middle of the night, you won't know what's going on for a few seconds. So that's what I want you to be prepared for, okay? Now, elsewhere, we need to talk about what's going on in South America with all these new eruptions. Okay, the new eruptions happening at Sabancaya let us know pressure has reached the central portion of South America, and it's pretty much bottlenecked right at the central point of the plate where our letter D is. It just so happens there were a few deep earthquakes that happened there a couple days ago. I want to say it was, how many days ago was that? That was like 5 days ago that they happened. So since then, just multiple new blasts, but no new earthquakes to the north. Well, that is going to change. There's going to be new earthquake activity in Central America and South America, specifically South Central America and North South America. And we'll bring in and name the countries that we're going to watch. We're going to watch the halfway point in two locations. First of all, I would like to take into account the one earthquake striking next to Nevados del Ruiz volcano. I think that earthquake is a result of the previous activity that struck there. But if we look between our two sets of earthquakes, all the way to the north in Mexico and all the way down here to the south at Chile-Argentina's border, our halfway point between those two zones, between all these bends, brings us back right in here into Ecuador and South Colombia. And the earthquake that should strike, well, guys, we have new deep earthquakes over here over the last day. And we haven't seen any new activity at Reventador volcano or earthquake activity here, which means there is a potential for above 5.0, and I'm leaning more towards like a 5.3 or maybe even a 5.4 to be striking. The last 5.5 that hit here caused two fatalities. Now we just have to go back a couple days. And El Salvador was hit. El Salvador was hit, and two people died down there. And we issued a three-day warning for them, and they had 3 days warning, and then it hit. And now we have some dead people there that just didn't get the warning. Well, it's going to happen again. It's going to hit at the central point here, the central point across this whole region. And it's going to be larger. It really is, because of the deep earthquakes over here where our letter D is. As we get, again, we've talked about this time after time after time, we'll ultimately see a new earthquake strike down here at the South Sandwich Islands where nobody lives, where our X marks the spot is. Speaking of X marks the spot, our most recent earthquake striking here over the past, let's see, the most recent large earthquake to strike has struck out here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge next to our letter X. That's far enough away to not be considered directly on our X. Obviously, it's only got one part of the ring over it. But still, this is an earthquake we would expect to happen after we see earthquakes in South America. And look what hit over the past several days in South America. See all these fives? Okay, some of those fives went up and around, and I was expecting the earthquake to strike, and I even told you guys about this, to follow the arrow out to our letter X. And out here we have a 5.3. Well, if you add these up, look what we've got. We've got a 5.2, a 4.8, and a 4.8. If you add those together, that goes to 5.3 to 5.4. So we have total energy, a 5.3, striking back at the back end of the arrow. And then the pressure transfers out. And in this case, it went just beyond our letter X and went down the bend a little bit to the south or mid-Atlantic ridge. I wouldn't call that the south mid-Atlantic, I guess central mid-Atlantic ridge. Okay, but it's close enough. I mean, the reason that 5.3 struck is because of the 5.3 to 5.4's worth of energy back behind it. It's going to happen again down to the south. Just be aware, not that big of a deal. It will fulfill the forecast for that location. Now let's talk about New Zealand. For my people down in New Zealand, guys, hey, look, things are getting a little bit more calm now that the Taupo swarm stopped, now that the four is hit down at the central part of the island, which they just mysteriously keep downgrading over and over again. And as of the 11th, yesterday, there was that 4.0 earthquake. Today, when we look at the earthquake striking throughout the 11th, 12th, going into the 13th, here, these are the last 150 earthquakes reported by the New Zealand agency. So just in case I had people asking me, you know, where are you getting your earthquake information? This is coming from the New Zealand feed. So if you guys were to pull, if you guys were to have a copy of Earthquake 3D, you could pull the same New Zealand feed I'm looking at here, and it will give you the earthquakes that they say have struck. Now, I'm just showing you what they show me, so please don't fault me if they're, you know, a day behind. I know somebody was saying, you know, hey, you're showing your older earthquakes. These are the last 150 noteworthy earthquakes, I think above 2.0, or is it above 1.5? Maybe it's above 1.5, or maybe it's all 0.0. I think it's 1.5 and greater. No, there's some 1.4s on there. Maybe it's 1.0 and greater. I don't know. So I will find out. It doesn't say on the feed itself, so we'll find out. But I would assume it includes all the smaller earthquakes. That being said, look what's hit over the past several days. So we're incorporating in several days worth of earthquakes here. You can see our cluster spot south of Wellington still exists. And you can see our progression line of earthquakes still exists. You can connect the dots all the way across the Southern Alps and go right down here to the south tip where it meets back up with the plate boundary. And I told you guys many months ago, and we've been watching over the past several months this take place, that there's a new plate boundary connecting point forming between the south tip of the island and the north tip of the South Island. And that eventually we will see a progression that happens constantly through this range. Instead of going around the bend and coming down the plate boundary, it cuts across. And as it's cutting across, it's causing larger earthquakes. Now, what caused it all to begin with, guys? Did you know that the opposite side of the planet from you is Italy? Did you know that? The antipodal for Italy is here off the coast of New Zealand, over here, like right here. Central Italy, where the plate boundary snapped. You got to understand, New Zealand's plate boundary snapped, and Italy's plate boundary snapped within weeks of each other, both with 7.0 earthquakes, both causing ruptured plate boundaries.
on the antipodal, the opposite side of the planet. Isn't that ironic? I would say it's related in some way, because I would say that the planet would be expanding in some fashion, and our deep earthquakes that happened on both sides of the planet obviously are a sign of pressure coming up from the core up through the mantle, hitting the asthenosphere and the bottom of the plates, pushing out in both directions. And in this case, it was two directions, or maybe even many other directions that it pushed out. But the two directions that were affected were New Zealand and Italy, within weeks of each other. They have to be related. They were similar-sized earthquakes on similar-sized plate boundaries within just a couple of weeks of each other. Now, one other thing I'd like to say. If there's any new deep earthquakes up here to your north, it's going to increase the likelihood of more activity in central New Zealand. So a day and a half ago, you had a deep, 4.7, 4.8, right? That was followed by a 4.0 right at the plate boundary, central New Zealand. And if you see any new deep earthquakes like this, it's going to cause another round of deep or shallower earthquakes. But there's one thing that has not hit yet, and that is the 5.0 north of the north part of the island that I'm looking for to strike at the Kermadec. If it doesn't strike by tomorrow, we'll consider it a 100% earthquake forecast miss, and we'll have to figure out where the energy went. So sometimes it takes 1 to 2 days, maybe even three. That's why we put 72-hour watches on things, for this to happen, for the pressure to spread out across the plate. Now, the reason we're looking for a 5 to strike north of the catcher's mitt position in New Zealand is because of the previous round of deep earthquakes from 4 days ago. So 4 days ago, deep earthquakes caused 4s. Then we're looking for a 5. Still hasn't hit. We're on day 3, basically, of the watch. And that's when I really start to raise my eyebrows. When is it going to hit? If you live over in Asia, if you live in any one of the areas that don't have any earthquakes marked for the last day to 2 days, you really need to be on watch at this point, guys. This includes the area across Myanmar, which was hit by a smaller earthquake, but it hasn't been hit by the expected earthquake. We talked about it yesterday. We talked about watching in between our letter D up here in the Middle East. I'll highlight the earthquakes in blue so you get a good idea of where I'm talking about here, right here, okay? Watching between there and all the way down here at Mount Sinabung, where our letter V is. So watching between those two points, we find our halfway point, and that brings us back down into Myanmar at the India border. So it kind of matches up because we have another deep earthquake here that's pushing over. So China's going to be sandwiched in between it. It really is. And the plate boundaries are going to be hit. So if you live in Myanmar, or if you know somebody who does, or in eastern India, you should probably let them know that there's at least 5.1 to 5.2 activity coming into their area. And anything above a 5 is normally enough to cause some damage there. So we want to let them know. And time frame on that shouldn't be too long. Last night was night 1. Tonight's night 2. I would say by night 3 or 4. So we might have 2 days still, maybe 2 days at the most. All those blasts at Sinabung are deforming the plate boundary and putting pressure out to the west, over towards Europe. Now, over towards Europe, we talked about this last night. We talked about watching in Iran. Iran still has not been hit. That's good news for Europe. It's kind of buying you a day without any 5.0 activity striking down in the Mediterranean. But like I told you, in Italy, 4.0 activity is returning in Italy due to the new deep earthquake and due to the pressure coming in off the previous 4s. Right now, you only have 3s. Coming in. But if you add these 3s together, look what we got, guys. Just if you add the 3s together alone, it takes you to a 4.1. 3.8 plus a 3.5 is a 3.9, and plus another 3.5 is a 4, maybe plus another 3.7 if these aren't duplicates, then you're looking at maybe a 4 to 4.1. And a 4 to 4.1 pushing into South Mediterranean means there is a potential for a 4, maybe 4.1 to be returning in Western Turkey, north of Crete. And the reason we're going to look north of Crete, this is all coming from the north, on the north part. Look at, we have two arrows to choose from. One's on the north, one's on the south. Well, the northern arrow is being hit, which means the path is going to be to the north, and that then puts Romania and Poland into the mix over the next couple days as well, after we see the earthquake strike in western Turkey. But again, we're getting several days out. I want the people in Italy to know when the four hits, you know why. Because of the four that just struck a day and a half ago, down to your east, southeast. Plus, you have a new deep earthquake down below you, letting you know it's right there. It's on your doorstep. It's down below your doorstep. It's coming up underneath your house, okay? You know it's coming. And you've been told, don't be shocked, don't freak out when it hits. It's only going to be a four. But if I see anything else coming, we'll let you know at a moment's notice. All right? I'm mainly concerned with the United States right now. Japan, you guys are used to the 5.0 activity. I mean, if it does strike, if it's a 5.8 or a 5.9, it might shake things up a little bit to the point where you're alarmed. But I know people in Japan can handle this. I know you're cool. I know you're prepared. I know you guys are earthquake aware over there. So that's the good news for the people in North Japan. Look, guys, all I can tell you is that you can do your own forecasting. It's very simple. If I explain it to you, I can explain it to you in simple terms that almost anyone can understand. The way you forecast earthquakes, you first have to find your silent zones, the spots that haven't been hit in the last 48 hours at least. And when you look over 48 hours, it gives you a good spread of what's hit and what's ready to be hit. So if you have a silent zone and you find that there's earthquakes on both sides of that zone, you add up the earthquakes on both sides. In this case, we have two deep earthquakes over on one side and some shallow earthquakes over on the other, which means the spot in between is going to be hit by at least one magnitude larger, possibly two magnitudes larger. One magnitude larger is 5.7, two magnitudes larger is 6.7, which means, for instance, this is a good example because it's a standing out silent zone, hasn't been hit yet in the past, well, last, what, 5 days without any earthquakes, which means it's going to be hit. It's a good spot to watch for a larger earthquake to strike. The halfway point between these two earthquakes along the red arrows. Now, it's been hit so many times over and over again, I don't think anybody will be shocked to see it hit there. But it should hit soon, okay? And when we talk about getting hit soon, the other spots. Look, when we talk about the deep earthquakes, they put pressure all the way over into areas thousands of miles away. We talked about this last night. Oh, what's going on here? Oh. 5.8 Chile, huh? Where's this? Hold on. Central Chile? Let's get our latitude and longitude coordinates and just go take a look. Uh-oh. That's big enough to cause damage. Mm-mm-mm. There it is. Wow. Okay, that's right next to it, guys. Here, hold on. They have this out in the ocean, but this is just a few hundred feet from the shore. Wow. Here's Nevados del, for reference, here's Nevados del Chilean. Okay. Oh, and Copahue, too, was erupting a few months ago. But here's Nevados del Chilean. That's the one that just most recently erupted a day ago. And this is how far to the north is that? Hold on. That's at least a couple hundred miles. 400 miles. 400 miles to the north. It's kind of in between where they have no volcanoes marked. Now, don't kid yourselves. There are volcanoes through here. They don't have them marked. I don't know why. They're downloadable from the Smithsonian for whatever reason. There's whole countries missing. All right. Well, that's a significant sized earthquake for the area. What's our nearest town? Do we have any towns nearby that could be damaged? Doesn't really look like it. No nearby cities at all. Wait, oh, what do we got going on here? Oh, wind power. Okay, all right, well, guys, take a look at where the earthquake is. Look where the arrow points. See that? Oh, they just downgraded it to 5.3. Look where the arrow points, and look where the earthquake struck. Now, we talked about this last night and the night before. We talked about the deep earthquake over here pushing all the way across the... You know what's ironic? Because I was just talking about how the deep earthquakes go across thousands of miles. These deep earthquakes over here a day ago led me to issue the warning out across the two arrows and told you guys both sets of arrows were going to be hit. Well, today, technically, I guess they were. You could count the 4.8 up to the north, but this is down to the south for sure, right at the tip of the arrow. I mean, it goes right into where it's pointing. The pressure comes across and hits South America like a wall. It has nowhere to go. It tries to go down underneath the plate and around the plate, like water hitting a wall. And in this case, it's caused now a mid-range to upper 5. So if you want to see the warning that was issued for Chile, you have to go back 2 days, I think, on my channel. Go back 2 days, watch the update from 2 nights ago, and you'll hear me talking about what to watch for at the tips of both red arrows. North red arrow is going to get hit, guys. North red arrow is going to get hit. And we still have time to get the warning out to the people down in South America at the Ecuador-Colombia border region and let them know that there's 5.0 activity coming, similar to what just struck down to the south. It's based upon where the arrows go back to, the origin point, the deep earthquakes that put this all into motion a few days ago. Okay? So, wow, you know, what a way to end up on this one. I guarantee you people down there felt that. If whoever's nearby there felt it. Just felt it. Now, they'll probably re-upgrade. You know what? Let's go check our station locations because I'm just not trusting the station locations on this. Let's go to the USGS site, see if they've got it. Latest earthquakes. They don't have it. Are you kidding me? USGS doesn't have it, guys. We're on their site right now. The last earthquake they have here is from yesterday. From like many hours ago, a little 4.0. Wow, okay, they don't have it here. Let me hit refresh. Let me make sure. Nope. And this is the international feed. Now it says magnitude 2.5 plus US. This is the international feed, guys. This is what you see when you come to their website. Look, it just refreshed too. It just refreshed and it's not there. Let me hit refresh again. No, they don't got it. It would be marked in red. They say the most recent earthquake is the one on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Okay, let's go to the EMSC. This is the European agency. Let's go to the seismologist page. Data contributions. Here we go. Chile. What do we got? What do we got? Okay, we're waiting on magnitudes to come in. Let's check the other stations from Geophone. 6.1, 5.8, 6.4, 5.6, 5.8, 5.6, 5.7, 6.4, 6.0, 6.3, 5.8, 5.7, 6.6, 6.2. 5.8, 6.6, 6.3, 6.4, 7.0, 6.8, 6.5, 6.6, and then a bunch that aren't reporting yet. Oh, no, we do have reporting. Furthermore, down the list, 6.6, 6.1, 5.7, 6.1, 5.9, 5.3, 5.8, 6.2, 6.0, 6.0. Going dipping down into the 5s, then back up into the 6s. All right. Well, that's a bigger one than what they're showing. 5.3. That's a huge downgrade. That's a full magnitude downgrade. Power of 10. But look, 5.3 and 5.3, right? Okay. Wow. All right, guys. I guarantee you they felt that one. With a 6, that's a 6. That's a 6. So if a 6 struck there, why did a 6 strike there? How about the deep 5? That they downgraded over here. It was a 5. How about that? It was. I knew it. This 4.7 that you see here was actually a 5, a deep 5.0 that they downgraded. But it started out, it clinged on the map, it was a deep 5. Then they did this downgrade game. But now, you can't hide the results of that. The follow-up across the plate is a 6. 5 here, 6 here. Happens almost on a regular basis, enough that we can put arrows pointing to regions and watch for certain magnitudes to strike based upon it. Okay, all right, guys.
we really need to be on watch on the West Coast with a 6-7 striking in South America with deep earthquakes like this. You see this? The whole, well, half the planet, let's call it half the planet, has moved on a deep level, all the way from Fiji, all the way over to Italy, and connecting in between with the earthquakes raised high off the globe. Over here in the East Pacific, Central America and South America have a few deep earthquakes. No deep earthquakes in the United States, but guess what, guys? We have our slow slip event happening up here to the Northwest, which I think would make up for those deep earthquakes. So now is go time. Let me get a sip of my coffee. Sent by a viewer from the Pacific Northwest, no less. Thank you. And by the way, guys, I appreciate your coffee treats because, man, it keeps me up and keeps me going nonstop. All right. Anyway, I got the P.O. box. You want to send coffee? Go ahead and send as much coffee as you want. Stop it with the donation stuff. All right. You guys are so awesome. So awesome. I want to tell my viewers much love. All my people who have given. I'm going to go ahead and hit refresh on this and see what we get. My viewers have come through over and over again. And thank you for giving to my Patreon. You have taken me above what I asked for. And the higher we go, the better it is. I mean, I'm not going to complain. But you guys already have taken me 200 over what I asked for on Patreon. Everything that comes in on Patreon is going towards me being able to grow my operation and make it bigger in 2018. So over the next 6 months, I've got to build up a nice little stockpile to get going where I want to go for 2018 with the dutchsinse operation. You guys are making that happen. YouTube cut our legs out from under us and literally have made it so I might be set to make $100 to $200 this month on YouTube. Yeah, and I'll show you at the end of the month when it's all said and done. I'll show you what I made last year versus what I made this year. You are not going to believe it. You're going to be like, dang, how could you do this as a full-time job? You can't, at least not with 200,000 subscribers, and that's unheard of on YouTube. When you have 200,000 subscribers, you should be able to do it as a full-time job. Everybody knows that, and with your, you know, getting cut out from under you, you guys are the only thing that's saving me from literally having to give up the operation entirely and go back into tree cutting and carpentry. And so, I mean, I'm willing to do that. That's not a problem. But I'd rather do earthquakes and forecasting. Who wouldn't? And I appreciate you guys making that happen. And if you would like to give to my Patreon, there is no pressure whatsoever. No future fundraisers. No future fundraisers. Whoosh, completely cut out forever. Because you guys are doing it through the work process. I work, you guys give. It's based on that. It's not based on me asking for anything. And I love that, and that's the best thing that we could ask for. It keeps me free from having to accept corporate sponsors. It keeps me free from having to go to the bank. And it keeps me free from having to sell out some kind of message for some kind of controlled multi-channel network on YouTube. So in exchange for all that, what can I say? The information's all free, and I'm here 24/7, 365 every day if something goes down. You guys have made it happen, and I thank you for doing that. What else do we got going on? I'm going to go back to the post office box tomorrow and go check again, because I know some people have sent some more stuff, and we're going to be doing the giant dutchsinse luck test. The dutchsinse luck test, guys. In case you don't know, American Geophysical Medal winner and the director of the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network, Professor John Padale. Quote Professor John Padale, dutchsinse is getting lucky like throwing darts at a board. And I said, hey, if I'm lucky, I want to put it to the scientific test and we will prove it. Well, look what my viewers sent me in the most recent unboxing. These are all $10 scratch-off lotto tickets, guys. From, California. So we'll see if we're lucky, but we're going to do it in an unscratch off luck video. So I'm probably going to do that maybe tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll do the Is Dutchsinse Lucky test. And it's going to be scientific because I've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of chances to win. That's going to be great. Okay, so guys, thank you for tuning in. Please have a plan and be prepared. Now, in all seriousness, I mean, I want you guys to be, you know, lighten up about it a little bit, but I want you to be prepared. Do not be scared. Now that you have the plan, now that you know which way the pressure is flowing, you can then make accommodations based upon that. And you can see the pressure coming at you. You can see the earthquakes popping off on their way towards you. You know to expect it. What's going on, guys? Chile was two different quakes. Dutch. What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? Oh, it was 216 kilometers deep? Really? Is that what you guys are trying to tell me? It was 216 km? Another quake in Argentina. Chile quake on land. Okay. All right. Well, let's see. What we got going on here? Yep, they moved the epicenter to on land. And we've got a second 5.4. Or is that another 5.4? Is that USGS or is that... Yeah, that's USGS weighing in on it. Hold on. EMSC reporting 1, USGS reporting 1. Hold on. Oval, Chile. 43-kilometer depth from the USGS. Gotta love this USGS stuff. Let's go to their latest earthquake feed. There we go, 5.4. Now let's go over to the EMSC for seismologist page. We've got our 5.4. I know you guys are pulling from multiple agencies, so you know I trust your readings. I mean, I don't think you guys are 17 minutes apart, two different Chile earthquakes. Geophone. Let's go over to Geophone. Feeds. Geophone. Boom. There we go. Geophone. Yeah, Geophone's got a new 4.5 reported as of 5 minutes ago. And that depth on that is 167 kilometers on the 4.5 on Geophone. Geophone, yeah, okay, I see it here. They've got it at a 5.3 now. Geophone got it at a 5.3 and a separate 4.5 in Argentina. So don't cry for him because it's not that big of a deal. However, that's a little pun. However, it's just under deep. We would consider anything over 200 kilometers to be a deep earthquake. This one is more in the crust. Like right at the bottom of the crust. Now, I'm not shocked by that because, again, these deep earthquakes over here where the letter D struck, or where they struck at the letter D, pushed up from underneath and then come up to a shallow depth and strike again. So there we go. That's interesting. Let me hit refresh on this. Now I've got Geophone running along with the others. We'll see if there's anything else that shows up on the coordinated feeds. Let me hit refresh. USGS, EMSC, Geophone. Okay, they just upgraded the earthquake to a 4.8, the deeper earthquake, and changed the depth to 76 kilometers. So it's not as deep of an earthquake. They just changed the depth on that earthquake and changed the magnitude to be larger. So it was a larger, shallower earthquake, not as deep. Still, though, I mean, it's still 76 kilometers. Okay, all right, well, there we go. That's really interesting. You know, it always, you know, when this happens towards the end, it seems like this happens towards the end of my updates. Start towards the end of the update, the areas that we're talking about and showing from the previous night's update start getting hit.
So it's just proof. They have a 24-hour warning almost exactly on most of these locations. And I was just bummed out. I mean, you know, it's going to happen. I know I can't blame myself. But I was really bummed out to hear that a couple people died in El Salvador. I don't want anybody to die when they can know when an earth. It's like not knowing that a tornado is coming. It's like seeing a house in the distance and you see a big tornado. And you're like, oh no, I need to warn that house that the tornado is coming. And they're not listening, or there's no siren is going off. And it's like watching a slow motion train wreck, quite frankly. Because it's just like, what can I do? I can't do anything. How am I supposed to get a hold of these people down there? How am I supposed to get a hold of all the people in the country of El Salvador and tell them to watch out for a 5.0 earthquake that could knock down one of their houses and kill them? Well, that happened. And it was a 5. So, you know, if it was a 6 or a 7, you know, I mean, God, would they have gotten the warning then? No. And it would have been hundreds of people dead, not just a couple. So I know I'm just kind of bitching to the wind or whatever, but I've got to say something because it just bothers me, man. That person could have been the person to cure cancer or save another life or whatever. And I know when it's your time, it's your time. And I know I've got a lot of people who have deeply held religious beliefs about, you know, when it's your time, it's your time. But still, though, I want to try and help. It's like seeing somebody in a flood that you want to try and save. You might want to dive in and save them. That's just the kind of person I am. If I see somebody floundering in the water, I'm going to jump in and save them. If I see somebody in a burning building, I'm not going to let them burn alive. So if I see somebody that's standing at risk for an earthquake, I got to tell them. It just stinks that they don't get the warning. That's all. Anyways, guys, you got the warning. There's 700 or 800 people in here tonight that got the warning. You can get the warnings out to other people. You don't even have to mention my name. You can just type down the area that I warned for the people that you know in that area and just send them an email and say, hey, just heard you're sandwiched between two locations. You're going to get hit next. And don't worry, it's only going to be in the 5 range, but you need to have a plan. And they'll love you for it. And if a bigger one hits, they'll be like, how did you know? And you'll say, well, you were sandwiched, you know, it was explained in this video. And you'll know, because I've explained it to you in the video, why the area is under pressure. You'll be able to give your relatives, friends, and other coworkers, etc., examples and say, this is why we're watching. We're not just blindly watching some area. We're watching this area in between this area and this area because these two areas just moved. Very specific. Okay? And that's all I got for you. So much love to everybody. And thank you again one more time for giving to my Patreon and giving to me overall. I would never have been where I'm at without your help. Peace out.